Welcome. Hello and welcome to today's ACM 6OFF webinar. This webcast is part of ACM 6OFF commitment to provide value to its current and future members. The ACM 6OFF webinar series features speakers from the POES, or Future of Software Engineering track at ICSE, as well as select keynote speakers and distinguished paper authors. So I'm Willem, professor at Stellenbosch University in South Africa, and it's my pleasure to welcome you today. So there are some housekeeping items you will see on the slide in front of you. Firstly, the slides will advance by themselves, so nothing to do there. If you are experiencing problems, F5 on Windows or Command R on the Mac, or otherwise kick your machine very hard and hopefully it will not fall over. To control the volume, adjust the master volume on your computer. And at the end of the presentation, the important part is that there'll be a Q&A, and you'll see a little Q&A box at the bottom, which you can click, and on there you can ask the questions. The session is being recorded and archived, so you can watch it again, and you will get a notification of it by email. Okay, so today's presentation is on software testing, a research travelogue. It's by Alex Orso from Georgia Tech and Gregg Rothermel from the University of Nebraska at Lincoln. So just to introduce our speakers, although they probably don't really need introduction, Alessandro Orso, we tend to call him Alex, is a professor in the College of Computing at the Georgia Institute of Technology. He received his PhD in computer science in 1999 from the Politecnico di Milano in Italy, and has been at Georgia Tech since March 2000. His area of research is software engineering with an emphasis on software testing and program analysis. And his interests include the development of techniques and tools for improving software quality and the validation of such techniques on real-world systems. He is currently a senior member of the ACM. Gregg Rothermel is a professor and Jensen Chair of Software Engineering at the University of Nebraska at Lincoln. He received his PhD in computer science in 1996 from Clemson University, working with Mary Jean Harrell. His research focuses on software testing, program analysis, and end-user software engineering, with an emphasis on the application of rigorous empirical studies. He is an ACM Distinguished Scientist. Now, we are having a few, or one minor technical difficulty, and Gregg hasn't been able to join us yet, but he hopefully will join soon. But Alex and Gregg, in your absence, we look forward to your presentations today.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Willem, and thank you everybody for being here and listening to the webinar, whether you do it in real time or after the webinar is recorded. And so I'm going to just start right away with the main topic for today's presentation. And so the title of this is this talk or this webinar is Software Testing a Research Travelogue from 2000 to 2014. And this is this webinar is based on a paper on the future of software engineering. This is a track that is presented at ICSE at kind of regular interval. And basically, the goal of the track is to discuss the main advances on different areas. So what we did, we took the materials there and we adapted it for this webinar, working on a kind of similar content. And I'm going to start this presentation by motivating why there is so much interest in software testing. And as soon as the next slide pops up, we'll be able to talk about this. Ooh. Okay, so this is not really a technical problem. So this is a simulated failure. But it's actually one that, I'm sure, it occurred to me and I'm sure it occurred to many of you as well. And that's exactly the real motivation why we do software testing. So we do software testing, we do software verification in general, because we would like to try to limit the number of occurrences of this failure that occurs on the user's machine when the software is deployed and used by the public. And since I would imagine that at least some of you must be software engineering researchers, I'm going to provide a few more examples related to possibly your experience. So this is a conference submission system, for example, and this is something that happened to me once where we were trying to submit a paper to a conference. And as you can see, basically the page says that there was an error submitting the paper. So this is a web application that failed in a very important moment. So when we were trying to submit a paper, luckily, eventually we managed to do that. And just to be fair, I'm going to mention also another submission system. And in this case, the bug that I experienced was while I was submitting a review. And you can see it right here highlighted in this kind of red part. And it says category E found on review form instead of D, T, E, or N. So it's not clear exactly what went wrong in this case. And even if you're not a researcher, you might have sent, you know, you might be a runner, for example. And you know how, you know, bothersome it is when you go for a run and the software that you're using to track your run doesn't really behave as expected and you cannot track your progress. Or, you know, even if you're not a runner, I'm sure you must have sent some tweet in the past or, in your present. And this is another example of a failure in which Twitter basically was down and was not behaving as expected. And, you know, even worst of them all, I mean, what really, you know, gets us upset is when our games don't work. Like, for example, this is a case in which a very famous game failed and so prevent the user from playing. But at any rate, you know, whether the example is this one or, you know, any of the many other ones that I experienced and I'm sure the audience has experienced, the overall message here is that software is buggy. And that's why software verification is so important to generate so much interest. And when we talk about software verification, the main the technique used in software verification is definitely software testing. So software testing is the most used approach for verification nowadays, and it's also the most investigated one in the case you are a researcher. And in fact, you know, when we were preparing this talk, what we did was to go and look at the proceedings for one of the main conferences in software engineering, ICSE, the International Conference on Software Engineering. And what I'm showing here is the number of papers on testing at ICSE from 2000 to 2014. And as you can see, you know, besides the fact that the number is, you know, tends to be growing, if you just look at the absolute numbers, you can see that if you consider the size of the proceedings for this conference, the testing papers are taking up basically 15-20% of the overall program. So one paper out of five is basically a paper on testing. And just to give you one more data point on the relevance of testing, this is the submission data for the Foundation of Software Engineering Conference in 2012. And as you can see here, also in this case, clearly testing and analysis, so basically verification of some form, dominate the number of submissions. So it's the highest number of submissions. And if you look at the red line, also the highest number of submitted papers. So basically what we were trying to do now that, you know, I hope I motivated, you know, why verification is important and why testing within verification is so important and the fact that it is actually very researched. What we did, you know, in this work was to basically to provide a travelogue. And what is a travelogue? So we're going to look at the definition from a dictionary. And in this case, it says the travelogue is a noun that says it's a movie, a book, or an illustrated lecture about the places visited and experiences encountered by a traveler. And in this case, we're talking about, you know, I guess, you know, an illustrated lecture of the experience encountered by testers and by people working on testing. And the travel that we're talking about is a travel that lasted 15 years. So since 2000. And I would also like to take this occasion to mention a person that, you know, was a very special person to me and, you know, a very important person for many other people in the community. And it's also the person who wrote the previous version of this paper, of this work in 2000. And this is Mary Jean Harrell. So Mary Jean passed away sadly on September 2014. And this is a person who was, she was Gregg's advisor, and she was also a very special person to me because she was my advisor during my postdoc. And she did a lot for Gregg and myself. And in fact, probably neither Gregg nor I would be here today if it weren't for Mary Jean. And the reason why we want to mention her, besides the personal reason, is that she also did a lot for the software engineering community and in particular for the testing and analysis community. So we would like to take this occasion to remember and acknowledge Mary Jean, and so without doing it, you know, really on a somber note, but it's mostly like a celebration of Mary Jean, and we would like to dedicate this seminar to Mary Jean's memory. Now, going back to our travelogue, what were our goals when we started this work? Well, we had two main goals. So the first one was to discuss the most successful research in software testing since 2000, so since the previous paper of this kind. And the second one was also to identify, given you know the state of the art, what are the most significant challenges and opportunities in this area. And we wanted to just not just provide our perspective because, you know, despite the fact that, you know, both Gregg and I have been involved in, you know, software testing, research in software testing for a number of years, we didn't want to provide a biased view. So what we did instead, we decided to involve the community in this effort. And so we contacted over 50 colleagues in our area, so people working both, you know, in industry and in academia on testing. And we asked them two questions. So first we asked them, what do you think are the most significant contribution to testing since 2000? And so since we know that we at least we academics tend to be a little self-centered, we made sure to tell them that you know it didn't have to be their work, so they could also talk about other people's work. And the second question we asked is that we asked them what they thought was the biggest open challenges and opportunities in the area of testing. Among these 50 people, we got about 30 responses. And it will be very complicated to summarize here all these responses. So what I'm going to do instead, I'm going to use a very concise way of showing what the outcome was. And I'm going to do it using a word cloud. So this is a word cloud that was constructed basically out of all the 30 responses that we got. And just to make it a little easier for you to consume this word cloud, I'm going to show you also what we did when we analyzed besides the word cloud the actual responses, and how we, based on those responses, we identified kind of three main areas. So in terms of contributions, we identify both research contributions and practical contributions, and I'm going to say more about this. And also, you know, besides we identified, since this was one of the things that we asked explicitly to our colleagues, a set of challenges and opportunities in the area of testing. So in terms of research contributions, we have four main areas, which are automated test input generation, testing strategies, empirical studies and infrastructure, and regression testing. And within this area, we have also a more detailed kind of analysis and a more detailed description and set of topics. And I will encourage you, since we're not going to have time to cover all of this during the webinar, if you're interested in a specific topic, to go and look at the paper in which we explain and we cover all of these different topics in detail. And as you can see, the different topics for the different areas. In terms of practical contributions, we have two main topics that we're going to cover today. And we also have a set of topics in the area of challenges and opportunities. And we will discuss those at the end of the webinar. And the basic message here is that if you look at this set of topics and contributions and challenges, obviously there are so many things that we could talk about. And unfortunately, we don't have all the time that would be necessary to discuss those. So what we're going to do instead is to identify a subset of these topics and cover those in more detail. And as I mentioned before, in case you're interested in parts that we don't cover, you can go and look at the paper, which is available, I think, from both my webpage and Gregg's webpage. And so the first topic that we're going to cover is automated test input generation. And for each topic, I'm going to show you, just to keep ourselves honest, the fact that it was also clearly indicated by the word cloud. So the first one, as I said, is automated test input generation. The second topic that will be covered by Gregg is regression testing. The third topic is sort of in between, practice and research, which is empirical studies and infrastructure. And then we have two more. The first one is a topic that is not directly related to research, but it has a lot of impact. And so those are the practical contributions to the area of testing. And finally, we're going to cover a new area, something that is emerging in these very days, which is the idea of leveraging the cloud and the crowd to do a better job with testing. Okay, so at this point, we're going to start directly and jump directly into these topics. And I'm going to start from the first one, which is automated test input generation. And the basic idea for automated test input generation is you would like to have some technique, some tool, that given an application, which is the one indicated here, creates some inputs for this application, and you know, using different techniques. And the goal of this generation will be is normally to achieve some coverage goal, just because coverage is a good proxy for kind of exercising the behaviors of a given application. And or in particular, it could be reach a given point or state. Like for example, if you know that there are some assertions in the code, you might want to try to cover these assertions. And this is by no means a new area. So there has been research in you know, input generation for decades, really. But in a sense, there has been a kind of big resurgence in the last 10, 15 years in this area. And the main reason for this resurgence is actually there's many reasons. Besides the technical improvement, there's also the fact on some more practical aspects. For example, the fact that we have now much more powerful machines, much more powerful decision procedures that, you know, and some of these techniques and many of these techniques leverage these decision procedures. And also the fact that there's been a lot of interest and a lot of effort put into careful engineering. So taking solutions that maybe were existing before on paper and make them work in practice. And if you've ever done that, you know that it's far from trivial, actually going from the definition of the technique to something that actually is a tool that you can apply on real software. And based on the, you know, the input that we got from our colleagues, there were four main areas for automated test input generation that were mentioned and areas that provided new contributions in these 15 years. And those are symbolic execution, search-based testing, random and fast testing, and also combinations, various combinations of this technique. And today I would like to focus on one that I think is really one of the main contributions, but also the one that was most commonly mentioned by our colleagues, which is symbolic execution. So we're going to talk about some of the technical improvements that we witness in the area of symbolic execution. And since I'm not everybody here might be familiar with symbolic execution, I'm going to give you a very, very quick primer of symbolic execution. And I'm going to do it using a simple example. This is a program that we call TestMe. And the program takes two input X and Y, and performs some computations. And as you can see, if some given set of conditions is satisfied, then you will reach this fail point. So you can imagine the goal of my testing to try to generate inputs that will reach this point, or making sure that, you know, these inputs cannot be generated. The way in which symbolic execution works is that instead of executing the program with a concrete set of inputs, we do it using symbolic inputs. So in this case, our symbolic inputs are x0 and y0, which are indicated here in the symbolic state. And so the two components, the two kind of aspects that I keep track of during symbolic execution are the symbolic state and the path condition. So the symbolic state indicates the state of the memory based on or as expressed as a function of the symbolic input. And the path condition tells me what are the conditions on the input so that I follow the path, the current path. So when I start symbolic execution, since I'm just entering the program, the symbolic state is just the state of the input, and the path condition is just simply true because I haven't made any decision yet. So imagine that we want to reach this point, which is the point of failure, and to do that, we will have to follow this path that goes from 1 to 3, skips 4, and gets into this if for which the value should be true, and then reach the point of failure. So if we do symbolic execution, so we keep track of the symbolic state and the path conditions as we follow this path, what happens is that by the time we reach this fail statement, this failing assertion, we have this symbolic state, so the x and y haven't changed because there's nothing that redefines x and y. Z is equal to x0 minus y0, because of the statement here at line 5. And the path condition is x greater or equal than 0, and the y0 greater than x0 divided by 2. Why? Well, the first one comes from the predicate at line 3, since the only way to reach the statement at line 7 is to skip the return value, the return statement at 4. Therefore, this condition, x less than 0, must be false, which means that x must be greater or equal, greater than or equal to 0. And since x is equal to x0 at that point, the first part of the path condition will derive from there. The second one is the second condition is y greater than z at line 6, which has to be true for the program to fail. And since the value of y is y0 and the value of z is equal to x0 minus y0, if you do the math, this is what you will obtain. So once you have your symbolic state and your path condition, what do you do? At this point, I want to know whether there is a set of input that will satisfy this path condition and therefore will lead the program to this failing state. And the way in which this is done is normally by passing this path condition to a solver, and the solver, if successful, will produce a solution. And in this case, it could produce, for example, the solution x0 is equal to 1 and y0 is equal to 1. And what that means is basically all I have to do is to provide these two inputs and the program will fail. So it's an automatic generation of the inputs that will reach a specific point in the program that I'm interested in. So I'm just going to mention, of course, you know, there's many technical difficulties in getting this to work in practice. And one of these problems, and that there was targeted by research, is the problem of, let me see if I can change the slide here. Okay, well, this slide is popping up. Okay, so imagine now that here at the line 5, what I have is that instead of having a simple operation, I got a complex function. So a function that the solver cannot, that will generate constraints that the solver cannot handle. So these constraints will go beyond the theory supported by the underlying software. So in this specific case, if I compute my path condition, including this complex function here, this is the path condition I will get. And if I pass this condition to a solver, normally what I will get is that the solver will not be able to generate a result. So I will not get an answer from the solver. So one of the contributions, one of the very important contributions, breakthrough contribution in this area, is a new technique that is called dynamic, has different names really, but you know, one of the kind of the most accepted names is dynamic symbolic execution. And the idea with dynamic symbolic execution is that in addition to keeping track of the symbolic state, you also keep track of the concrete state. And in this case, for example, imagine that our inputs are x is equal to 10 and y is equal to 10. And therefore, when you get to a path condition where it is too complex for the solver to be handled, what you do, you replace the value of this of the part of this condition that cannot be handled, in this case, the complex function, to its actual value, the one computed using the concrete state. And when you do that and you pass it to the solver, in this case, the solver will be able to give you a solution. And this solution, when passed to the program, will cause actually the program to fail. Now, I mean, you know, I skipped a lot of, you know, technical issues, like, for example, the fact that there could be problems of divergence. Since you're replacing a specific value into the path condition, it could be that, you know, this solution changes actually the value of complex function, and therefore you don't reach this point. And there's been, you know, kind of several techniques that have been, kind of alternative techniques that have been proposed to address these kind of issues. But the general message here is that, you know, this really allows to kind of break this current ceiling of symbolic execution and to apply symbolic execution to a lot of cases that were not possible before. And in fact, you know, these techniques have had a great success, and a great success both in academia and in industry. So I just want to cite a few. So, for example, for the academic side, countless citations of this paper. For instance, over 1,300 citations for DART, which was one of the first papers discussing dynamic symbolic execution, and also, you know, a number of publications, various applications, a number of tools have been developed that implement these techniques, like CREST, CLI, PEX, SAGE, Symbolic JPF. And in terms of industry, these techniques have been applied very successfully at Microsoft, NASA, IBM, Fujitsu, and a number of other industries. So really a big success story of the, you know, kind of research contribution that made it to practice. I'd also like to mention some of the open challenges. So this is by no means a problem solved. So symbolic execution is still a very difficult technique to apply despite the success. And some of these challenges, which are, some of those are from symbolic execution, some of those are for automated input generation in general, are the presence of highly structured input. So the examples that I showed you were with very simple sort of integer input. But in many cases, the program will take complex data structures as input. So there's you have to address this issue. You have to be able to handle this data structure, for example, to be able to do automated input generation in those cases. External libraries are a problem because you cannot normally analyze all of the external libraries, so you have to find a way of summarizing them. Symbolic execution still has problems scaling to very large and complex programs. And finally, as a problem for input generation in general, defining oracles is still an issue. And I will talk about a little bit more about this later, but the problem is that even if you generate all the possible input for your program that you might need to test it, you still need something that tells you whether your test was successful or not. So it's not enough to just generate the inputs. Okay, now I'd like to kind of pass the baton to Gregg to talk about regression testing. So I'm going to check with Willem. Do we have Gregg now connected?
Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do.
All right. Then Gregg, all yours.
All right. Thank you. Sorry to all. I had this written down as 11:45 Central Time. All right. Regression test. And I assume I'm driving the slides now. Okay. Regression testing, of course, is the retesting of software after it has changed. And all systems that succeed end up changing in some way, evolving, or having bugs fixed, and so forth. And so regression testing ends up being a pretty important part of the software engineering process. So as a stylistic view of regression testing, in regression testing, you have a program D that is under maintenance, and you have a test suite T for that program. And the problem in regression testing is that somehow after you've maintained the program for a while or evolved it, it's changed and you need to retest it. And the question is, what should you do in that retesting? How should you do it? And one of the first things people thought to do was reuse the existing tests, and we call that the retest all approach. But that can be quite expensive. There's test suites that take weeks or months to execute, and or that involve lots of human effort. And you might think that if you've only changed some parts of the system that you shouldn't need all those tests. And so people have worked on that problem generally. And there was a 2009 survey by Yu and Harmon that found, so that's 6 years ago, that found that at that time there had been 168 research papers published on regression testing. So it was quite an active topic in the years up to that. And I don't have a recent general survey, but we'll see a little later that the amount of work going has gone up quite a bit on some of the topics. But what have people done in this area? Well, one thing is, the slide we'll click over. When you have a program and test suite, given that you've only changed some small part of it, you might not need to run all the tests. And regression test selection techniques try to look at your test suite, split it into the tests you need and the tests you don't, and allow you to run the test which, by some analysis, you deem more necessary for the changes in the program. There's a wide range of such techniques. Some of them, under some circumstances, can achieve what's called safety, can ensure that no tests are left out that could have revealed faults. But the conditions for doing that are quite difficult. So usually these techniques end up being pretty much risk-based. You try and do better at selecting tests and leave fewer out that would have revealed faults. So in Yu and Harmon's survey, there were 87 papers on that topic back in 2009. A second approach people have tried involves what's called test suite minimization. Now, over time, as your system evolves, you end up adding tests to the test suite, and the test suite grows. And you might eventually have redundant tests, test things that have already been tested. And minimization tries to address this by permanently reducing the test suite to a subset that gets, say, the same coverage of code or requirements or what have you as the original one. So reduction applies some heuristic and reduces T, and now you go forward into the future using that smaller T on further steps of the evolution. Yu and Harmon in their survey found 37 papers on that back in 2009. A third approach people have looked at is called test case prioritization. Sometimes you're not willing to eliminate any tests, and you want to run them all, but if you've got a long-running test suite, it might be beneficial to run first the ones that have greater chances of exposing faults, because then maintainers can get working on the problems associated with those. Or if you don't know how much time you're going to have to run tests and you prioritize them, you can hope that you've run the most important ones first. So prioritization, given the changed version of the program, takes the test suite and orders the tests in it by some heuristics. An example would be the amount of coverage the tests get. And your hope is to maximize some testing objective, such as rate of fault detection, of early fault detection. So in 2009, there had been 47 papers on that. A more recent survey found over 170 papers on that. So there's been obviously quite a bit of work being done on that topic. So these are three areas that of heavy research on the regression testing topic. Most recently, what's been happening? Well, many of the techniques people come up with are looking at more sophisticated heuristics, like search-based heuristics and AI-based. The initial techniques that people looked at tended to be based just on, say, code coverage or something simpler, like trying to greedily order tests based on their code coverage. But more recently, there are these stronger heuristics being looked at. There's also been a lot more work on empirical studies of testing techniques, and I'll be talking about that a little more in the next section when we get to empirical studies. And some new topics emerging. One we call test suite augmentation. When you've used your existing tests, there probably are still some parts of the code, some changes that haven't been tested. And augmentation addresses this by trying to generate tests that cover things that in the evolved system are no longer adequately tested. And then people are also looking at new software domains, such as regression testing of web applications and regression testing of GUI applications. What's needed next? Well, on my view, greater industrial uptake. It's surprising to me how little of this work has been taken up in the industry, at least that we're aware of. I am aware of some companies using some of these techniques, and I know that Intel, for instance, has a tool that does, I found on the web, that does selection and prioritization. But there was a study done, a survey really of software engineers done by Engstrom and Runesson recently. They were talking to engineers in Sweden, so there's some limitation there. But they discovered essentially that the practitioners they talked to had many concerns beyond those addressed by the selection and prioritization techniques, like test automation, test design, test suite maintenance, that sort of thing. And so one could argue that we need to do a better job understanding practitioners' problems and needs. Also, a lot of the empirical work, although I said a lot more empirical work is being done these days, a lot of it's been controlled studies in the lab, and those are important, but you'd like to go beyond those to industrial case studies that look at practitioners' actual papers. And then the slide went ahead faster than I wanted it to. And then the other thing that I think is needed is consideration of specific practical processes. There are lots of different engineering processes being practiced, and where techniques are concerned, one size doesn't fit all. So, for instance, these are some sort of stylized processes in this slide, but I mentioned the traditional, we'd call batch process, where back when I was a software engineer, we'd work on the next version for 2 or 3 months, and then we'd test it for a few weeks, and then we'd release it. And we'd do that in part because a release entailed putting it onto a TK50 tape and sending it out. Well, that's not required anymore. And people are moving toward more incremental processes. So you might imagine a process where maintenance goes on for 3 weeks, and then testing for a week, and maintenance 3 weeks, and testing for a week, until the end when you wrap up, or even more incrementally, test every night approaches, you're coding during the day and testing at night. And most recently, what's called continuous integration, where changes are being made to the system almost continuously, and tests are being run as those changes are made. And that's being practiced, that's been reported on in papers as being practiced by folks such as Google and Facebook and Mozilla. And so what's happening here is the time you have, sort of the analysis time to decide on some things you want to do is getting less and less. In the traditional model, you had 3 months to gather data that might help you speed up your testing. In the incremental, the next row below that, you got a lesser amount of time. And as you get further down, you have less and less time for analysis to support the testing. And some of the techniques that worked in the less incremental models no longer function. And so I think that's a big thing to do, is to work on these different process models. And that's the end of my slides. Back to Alex.
So Gregg, now it's actually the part on empirical studies of infrastructure, which is still yours.
You know, I just went through that. Did I get cut off? Oh, no.
Oh, sorry. Then I didn't see it on mine. Then it's
no,
fine.
No. We're good. We're good. Sorry. Again, rushing into this and being late bollocks me. Empirical studies. Thanks, Alex. Okay, testing techniques are heuristics, and they need to be empirically evaluated. It's not enough to just analytically evaluate them. Back in 2005, we did a survey of the papers that we found that were on testing techniques. At that time, the papers from the range 94 to 2003, there were 224 of them, and over half of them had no empirical evaluation at all. 4% did their evaluation by demonstrating a technique on an example. 27% would choose a single system and do a study on them, and only 17% contained anything in the way of controlled experiments. And things have changed quite a lot since then. I'm on a lot of program committees, and these days if a paper on a testing technique comes through and there's no empirical evaluation, it's not likely to be accepted. And conferences are also conducting artifact evaluations where authors can submit the objects they experiment on, the programs and what have you, or the tools that they created, and those get evaluated for their reusability in further experiments. So that helps with reproducibility of experiments. So what changed? Well, I think one of the greatest changes was the increased availability of objects to experiment on. 15 years ago, if you wanted to run experiments, you had to find some programs to experiment on, and they weren't as easily accessible, and there might be programs without versions, and for some kinds of experiments, you need programs, versions, tests, faults. Well, now there are repositories that make those things available. At UNL, we maintain the SIR repository that a lot of people have been able to use in papers, and there's several others listed here. And increasingly, there are more relevant open source systems available that people can do their experiments on. And often they have versions and tests and bug reports. So that's lowered the bar on being able to do experimentation quite a bit. People are also making supporting infrastructure available more often than they used to. So the tools you use in your experiments or the tools you create that you're experimenting with, more people are making them available, and that helps with reproduction of experimental results. And finally, I think there's an increased understanding of empirical methodologies. Because there are more people doing them and writing them up, people are now following more sound methodologies and reporting their results in sounder ways. What's needed next? Well, I had mentioned earlier we need more case studies of industrial systems, and I think that will help. We can still use more controlled studies of more realistic systems as well. A lot of the studies that are being done are still looking at systems that are kind of trivial. But I think case study of industrial systems is a larger need. And then we need to move beyond tool and technique studies. A lot of the studies in our area are going to look at, say, a test case generation technique and compare it to some others. But as I've written here, if you build it, they will come. Doesn't necessarily work with software engineering tools. You can create a tool that looks good according to some metric, but engineers won't want to use it for some reason. Maybe it makes too many false positives or something of that sort. And so I think we need to move beyond tool and technique studies to actual studies of humans. And now we move back to Alex.
Okay. Well, thank you, Gregg. Just want to check whether you already clicked on the slide. Perfect. Okay, so now we're going to talk about, you know, practical contributions. And the thing here is that when we got the feedback from our colleagues, not all the feedback pointed to research results. And in fact, you know, some of the discussion was really about more practical contributions. And although these are not research, they had really a big impact on research as well. The first one is frameworks for text execution. And basically, well, what happened here is that, you know, with the advent of, in particular, JUnit, people started to encode their test cases in a sort of standard format. And that dramatically improved the state of the art, because by having this de facto standard, for example, IDEs could rely on the fact that the test cases were going to be on a given format and therefore integrate test cases automatically. And but indirectly, as I said, it also affected research, because this idea of having a standard format also gave us, you know, when I say, you know, us as researchers, a way of encoding, for example, the test that we generate in a standard way. And that, you know, allows for sharing artifacts, reproducing results more easily. So in the end, it had both, you know, a practical and a theoretical or more conceptual set of contributions. And as I said, you know, the most you know, famous example of the framework for text execution is JUnit. But then, you know, after that, you know, there have been basically these similar frameworks for pretty much any kind of language and platform, including MUnit, PHP Unit, HTTP Unit, and so on. And the second thing that I want to mention, you know, just quickly, is because, you know, also Gregg already talked about this, is basically the shortening of the testing process lifecycle. So we witnessed the movement from a situation in which people were kind of developing, testing, releasing, to a situation in which there's really kind of a blended set of phases, and software is continuously integrated and released. And even though this is a practical contribution, I also feel like there are some also more researchy issues here at hand. Like, for example, there is an interesting future challenge is how to further shorten the save compile check cycle and move the checking even closer to the IDE, so that developers can ideally obtain feedback as they code. And not only the syntactic feedback that is provided nowadays by IDEs, but also kind of a more semantic kind of thing. But like, for example, the fact that they broke something as soon as they write the code that breaks that part. So basically shortening this so that it becomes almost kind of a real-time kind of feedback. Continuous integration, as Gregg mentioned, is widely used in industry. And in terms of, you know, practical tools, there are several examples, like, for example, Hutton, Jenkins, Travis, and several others. Okay, the last topic that I'd like to cover is the one about leveraging cloud and crowd. And this is kind of a more kind of very recent effort. And the idea here is that, let me see if the slide comes up. Basically, in general, software is increasingly built and run on remote resources. So it is only natural to start thinking about using the cloud for also various aspects of testing. And this becomes particularly relevant in the case of, for instance, cloud IDEs. So if our IDEs are also in the cloud, then basically there's a kind of a seamless integration with these remote resources. And so it becomes much easier to do, for example, the kind of things that I was mentioning before in terms of continuous integration and continuous feedback to users. And in terms of, you know, cloud IDEs, I mean, I'm just going to provide a few examples. And nowadays, there's really a number of these possible solutions. And they could be kind of a venue towards, I mean, I know there's, for example, interest for this in various companies, a venue towards having this sort of more kind of in the cloud, also quality assurance activities. So it's just natural, basically, for testing to follow this movement. The second thing, which is a little more research, is this idea of leveraging the crowd for testing. And the fact, you know, the reason why this makes sense is because testing is still a very much human-intensive activity. And therefore, leveraging the crowd makes a lot of sense because, I mean, it's you know, leveraging basically as many humans as possible. And it might sound far-fetched, but actually that's something that's been happening for some time already, both in academia and in industry. So in academia, for example, we've seen several efforts that try to leverage remote resources in order to improve the way in which software engineering tasks are performed in-house, including regression testing, performance testing, and debugging. And in terms of academia, in terms of industry, for example, all the whole idea of incremental releases are basically testing with the crowd, because you release your new version of the software to a subset of the population, and they're basically testing it for you to some extent. So it is really a form of crowd testing that is, you know, very much used. And there's also, you know, some interesting new directions here. Like, for example, one that I think is particularly kind of intriguing is this idea of doing game-based testing and verification. So you start from a possibly very complex problem, and you want to transform that in simpler problems that people can kind of solve while playing games. And the challenges here are that, you know, if you really want this to work, if you really want to kind of do testing or verification as a game, this must be a game that people are willing to play. And also, it has to be such that it must be easier than the original problem. So you cannot have the same complexity in the game that you have in the original problem, otherwise it doesn't really work. So in summary, and to conclude, as you saw, basically, there's a number of topics that have been investigated in these 15 years. So the real kind of overall message that we want to give is that there's been an incredible amount of work on testing. And if you look at the way testing is done, so some people might think that actually things have not changed that much because, people are still testing in the same way. But we will argue that this is not the case. So we will argue that there's a lot of important changes that have occurred in the last 15 years that go from, the fact of having automated testing, a better empirical evaluation, so that now that we know that when we evaluate our techniques, they're more likely to work in practice because we use the more realistic test bed. We have better testing strategies, better testing tools. The testing process, in particular, this idea of continuous integration has changed a lot. So in more general terms, we believe that with automated testing and all these other techniques, there is clear evidence that the testing process has improved. So it transformed from an ad hoc, often neglected activity to something that is considered essential for the quality of the software and then is kind of tightly integrated into the development process and very often performed by very skilled professionals rather than just beginners. So now just to conclude, in terms of just a few future directions, and then before we get to the quality, to the questions and answers. And I always like to say when I talk about future directions of work, that it's very hard to make predictions, especially about the future. And this is sourcing clear because some people kind of attribute this to Yogi Berra, but apparently, to the late Yogi Berra at this point, apparently there's possibly coming from other sources. But anyways, that it's very difficult, but if you twist my arm, I'm going to tell you what I think might be the most promising venues here. And speaking about from the research standpoint, testing real-world systems is one of the first ones. So this idea, we make a lot of assumptions when we define our techniques and we evaluate our techniques, but nowadays systems are increasingly distributed, built with multiple languages, and so on. And therefore, unless we kind of drop some of our assumptions, our techniques might not be really applicable. So I believe that doing this will actually increase the applicability of these techniques. We still have the problem of oracles. So there's no real support to generate in an automated or semi-automated way oracles. And if we get better and better at generating tests, we should also follow with the generation of oracles. There's some novel interest in success in the use of probabilistic approaches, so approaches that not only tell you whether an interesting effect, effect of the interest, such as the failure of the assertion, can happen, but they can tell you whether it can happen or not with some probability. And that would allow you, for example, to do to reason in terms of reliability, to focus your testing effort, and so on. There's increasing interest in a need for testing non-functional properties, in particular on mobile platforms. The whole idea of testing for energy, of testing for performances, that's something that might be, were a little more neglected on more traditional platforms. The one before the last is the idea that with the increasing availability of programming environments that allow the common person to write software, like for example R or App Inventor, then the democratization of computing is happening, but this will also contribute to the democratization of bugs. So we need to be able to support this kind of end user programmers and allow them to test their code without being really software engineers. And I just mentioned the fact that basically leveraging the cloud and the crowd is something that is very promising, and it's happening, and it's likely to happen even more in the future with the fact that we're all more connected and we have more and more platforms that rely on the internet. So I'd really like to conclude with a personal message, and that's something that I feel very strongly about, so I wanted to make sure to mention it here. And it can be controversial, so it might be perceived in a controversial way, but especially for researchers, I really kind of like to ask people to stop chasing full automation, because I think we're trying to push and having kind of everything fully automated. So when we write papers, when we write techniques, for various reasons, right, including the fact that it's easier also to evaluate these techniques. But this is not true only for testing, but also for different areas. that, you know, debugging, program repair. I believe that the real key is to use the different players for what they're best at doing. So my strong suggestion here, whether you're doing testing or other similar techniques, is to really use the human for creativity and to use the machine or the computer for the computation-intensive, repetitive, and error-prone tasks. So, and I think that this kind of semi-automated or kind of including the user in the loop and kind of amplifying the ability of the and the intelligence of the and the creativity of the human is what is the key to success for testing and also for other techniques, as I said. So this concludes the webinar. I'd just like to kind of put on a slide in which we acknowledge all, you know, the people who contributed to this to the content of this webinar, and then we're open to questions and answers.
Well, thank you, Professors Orso and Rothermel. Let's start with the questions. So the first, well, actually, I have a whole bunch of questions here, so you're going to have to excuse me if I don't pick your question. Let's start off with a question from Adam Lomas. He says, today's speakers noted that there's increased research on software testing, but he's kind of curious how much of that is on the old style of, let's say, the waterfall model of development, and how much is now actually based on more agile things?
Gregg, anybody? Should I go? Want to go?
Go ahead.
Okay, I'll get it. Well, I believe that, you know, a lot of that, I guess this goes back to one of the things that was mentioned in terms of kind of testing real world systems. I believe that there's still some research that is making quote-unquote, the wrong assumptions, and necessarily so, because in some cases, if you want to tackle a problem, it's easier to say, well, let's constrain the problem and solve it there and then move to real-world system. But I also think that there's a lot of research, or maybe, you know, efforts in between research and practice, like, for example, the one moving towards continuous integration and continuous feedback to the testers that are very far away from the waterfall, and they're really more into the agile context. So it's basically moving towards the process that is kind of more modern, again, you know, quote unquote, but basically that leverages the realities of today's software development and today's kind of interactions within teams. I mean, I hope that, you know, answer some other question. And
also, in a follow-up question, Walter wants to know, do you know about any research about how test-driven development changed not only the testing process lifecycle, but the whole software development cycle?
Let me think. I go out on a limb here. I mean, I cannot pinpoint any paper. I'm pretty sure that there is at least some articles discussing the, you know, the whole impact of TDD. I'll be happy if you follow up with Gregg and me to try to look for some references and send them along. But I know that there's been a lot of research and studies on, you know, kind of the way the software processes evolved based on TDD. Mm-hmm. And in fact, actually, maybe I can point to an article or a paper. Maybe the paper between I think it's called Between Agility and Discipline. And remember, one of the authors is Barry Beam, and the second author is escaping now. I think that they discussed some of these connections between just, you know, the way of which agility, you know, meant as, you know, TDD or, you know, similar practices actually affected the whole development process.
Okay, so a kind of a more philosophical question from Pat. He wants to know, how do you respond to Dijkstra's criticism that testing shows the presence of errors but never their absence? You know, maybe another way to put this is, are we heading to verifying things, or are we stuck with testing?
I think that's a very good question. Gregg, do you want to take this one?
I wouldn't say we're stuck with testing, because people are working on methods that give more certainty, but I mean, such as model checking, but that, of course, has its problems scaling up and can't look at the full range of functional expectations about a system. So in many respects, I think we are stuck with testing, and that means accepting some risk in what we do and accepting the fact that we're not going to go out of business as testers very soon.
Okay, so one other question. You mentioned academic advances, but in testing. But what has been the biggest success for academic research in practice?
If you ask me, I mean, I would definitely say that, you know, the first one I mentioned, so this idea of a kind of symbolic execution techniques and their you know, their improvement with the kind of dynamic symbolic execution and various engineering solutions. And if you wanna, you know, if you wanna see hard numbers for that, I mean, Patrice Goffroy has you know, has given several talks that mention how, for example, the number of vulnerabilities found on Windows drivers after release, before and after using this kind of tools, in this particular case, the tool is called Sage, is dramatically different. And that's the clear example of the impact of something that was pure research into a very concrete practice. And that's, you know, to me, I mean, that is one of the most obvious and, you know, kind of contributions to practice by research. And if I can add something, I mean, there's also Greg talked about, you know, regression testing. I think there's more subtle kind of impacts also in that area, because there's been a lot of research, and, you know, Greg has been doing some of that. Really, it was a, you know, kind of one of the kind of early researchers in this area that transitioned, I strongly believe, transitioned to industry, but it's not, you know, through a kind of a direct link. So it might be hard to show that, but I think that kind of research also had an impact on various practices.
Okay, so then a question that I would love to know the answer to as well from Jeffrey. He wants to know, are there any software defect taxonomies that play a useful role in testing?
Could you repeat that? Are there any defects?
Basically, are there defect taxonomies that play a useful role in testing?
I guess I've seen some. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, I'm aware of a couple. There was one. I don't have it in front of me with the authors. I'm happy to look it up. But there was a study of the occurrence of JavaScript bugs in the wild, and I'm not sure I can say they have impacted testing, but they obviously could if someone wants to see the types of bugs that were encountered in the frequency of those bugs. That's one that I know of. I'd have to look around for others, but I have recollection that there are others. Alex?
Yeah, but I think I've seen several. I mean, the one you mentioned, and it also depends on what you mean exactly playing a useful role in testing, right? Like, for example, for mutation testing, if you're a believer in mutation testing, then, you know, error taxonomies are sort of everything, because that's, you know, your source of mutation operators. So I guess it really depends, and I feel like the main usefulness of defective taxonomies in practice is when doing inspections. And I know there's tons of catalogs for bugs and you know, the taxonomies of bugs and defects for various languages that are currently, that are, you know, kind of regularly used for inspections. And also in this case, I mean, I cannot really pinpoint one, but I mean, it would be probably easy to kind of find some.
Okay, well, I'm afraid, even though there's a whole bunch of questions here, even some on mutation testing that I would love to have asked you, we have run out of time. So I'd like to thank Professors Orso and Rothermel again for their informative presentation, insightful answers to the many questions, even the many they didn't get to. Special thanks to each of you for taking the time to attend and participate in today's webinar. This webinar was recorded and will be available online in a few days at sigsoft.org under resources. You can find announcements on upcoming ACM and SIGSOM webinars and other ACM activities at learning.acm.org or on the SIGSOFT webpage. And that's it. This is the end. Bye from Willem here. It's evening in my time, so I'm going to go and have a nice bottle of wine. Thanks again for joining us, and I hope you will join us again in the future.
Yeah, thank you all. Also from me. You know, it's been great to do this. And well, maybe we'll find a way to answer the pending questions in a blog or something along those lines. But, you know,
that's
thank you so
idea.
Much for attending all the questions.
Thank you all.